this week by talking about the fact that we are called to be fishers of men. It is the goal of our series of classes, these three, that we help expose you to many different techniques whereby you can bring people to Jesus Christ. I want to briefly touch on some things on this sheet that we covered last week. As we began talking about this subject, last week we cited two studies. One was from the Pew Forum on Religion and Public Life, a study that was made in 2014 covering some 7 years time frame since the last study, and also a book by George Barnett and his group called Churchless. And in these two studies, we can find several things that are very important to us. Number one, those who are considered religiously unaffiliated. That is, you ask them, are you affiliated with any religious group? Those that say, I am not, that group is growing faster than any other segment in religious circles today. To the tune of about 1% every year, this group is growing. Now, among those groups that claim to follow Christ, in those titled the evangelical groups, there is a heavy migration today in religious circles to non-denominational groups. And so that's good news for us as the Lord's church and the fact that we are non-denominational by God's design. Number three, regardless of church background, people in America as an adult, they will normally, 33% of them or so, will change religious groups in their lifetime at least one time. Now, there's some things that matter to those who are religiously unaffiliated, things that we might be very surprised about. So 1 in 3 say they are deeply spiritual. 2 in 5 say faith is important to my life. 3 in 5 will identify themselves as Christians, and 9 in 10, this is an interesting statistic of all the findings to me, 9 in 10 do not view religious groups or churches unfavorably. They either view them in a, I don't have an opinion like, or I slightly favor religious groups, or I'm heavily in favor of religious groups. And so only 1 in 10 has a bad view of religious groups and churches. And so that's a very interesting statistic. Now, the point of last week's class in the first part of our discussion was to simply say, we often have a myth that says people are not interested. And sometimes we form that opinion based on the experiences that we have gone through. If the people in my office, if they are not interested in the gospel, if the people on my street are not interested in the gospel, if people in my family is not interested in the gospel, I soon come to the conclusion no one must be. Yet statistics say otherwise. These are two nationally based statistics, not just on people in the north, not just on people in the west, but people also in the south, all across the United States. And so we're living in a day, yes, in which more and more people will identify themselves as religiously unaffiliated, but that does not mean that there is not an interest in the gospel. There are going to be fertile grounds for us to look at. And so even among those that we come into contact with, we will find from time to time those who are interested in the gospel. Now, last week we also focused on the fact that there are two types of methods we'll be talking about. One is indirect methods of bringing someone to Jesus Christ. We went to John chapter 1, 43 through 47 last week, and we noticed that Philip brought Nathanael to Jesus. Philip was not the one doing the teaching. He was not the one conducting the Bible study. But without Philip's involvement, Nathanael would not have been brought to Christ. And so, though Philip himself did not do the teaching, he was instrumental in the conversion of Nathanael. You and I can do that today, and that's what we're referring to as indirect methods of bringing someone to Christ. Next week, we'll spend all of our time in class talking about direct methods, so we'll skip over number 2 under letter B. Now, in terms of what we looked at last week, at the end of our class, we noticed that there are some use of published materials that can be helpful to us to give to other people or to send to other people that may be very helpful. Whether we're talking about tracts, some like we have even on our track rack outside the double doors here to your right, talking about a newsletter or a periodical, something like Reason and Revelation from Apologetics Press, The Spiritual Sword from Get Well Congregation in Memphis would fall into that category. Or whether it's a book like Muscle in a Shovel or From My Heart to Yours, as Brother Joe spoke to us about that last week, those are all tools that we can use. With caution note being, if we ever give anything to someone else, we need to do what first? Read it ourselves to make sure we are familiar with that. And so after looking at that, we're moving today into some new material. If you've not got a sheet, you'll raise your hand and I'll make sure somebody could. All right. Let's hit new ground today and let's talk about number two on the second page there. In regards to another indirect method than using published material, we're going to talk for the first part of class this morning about what I refer to as relational evangelism. Now, if you'll see the definition underneath, it's using current and future relationships with the lost as a means to bring them to Christ. You may or may not have ever heard the term relational evangelism in the past, okay? But how many of you have heard the term friendship evangelism? Raise your hand. Okay. What is friendship evangelism? It's exactly what it says. Trying to reach out to who? To our friends. To bring them to Jesus Christ. Now, I don't prefer the term friendship evangelism. This is the reason. When we say friendship, we're talking about a select group of people that we know. Now, let me just ask you this question. Are you friends with your next door neighbor? Are you friends with the person at work that sits across the aisle from you? Are you friends with a cashier at a store you do business with almost on a daily basis? You see, when we use the term friends, if we're not very careful, we can narrow this down to a select group of people. I prefer the term relational evangelism or relational reaching out to those that we know. Why? Because not everybody we have a relationship with is going to be considered our friend. But yet, if we have a relationship with them, then we can possibly utilize that relationship. Now, there are those in the religious world who knock what we call friendship evangelism or relational evangelism. And this is generally what is said among some circles. Relational evangelism, that is not really reaching out and biblically converting people as was done in the first century. There are those who will take shots at relational evangelism and they'll say, that's not the way they did it in the first century. I don't know what Bible those individuals are using, those critics, but yet when you go back to the pages of the Bible, I've got several examples down here, you see people using their relationships in order to bring people to Christ. John chapter 1, verses 43 through 47, Philip brought Nathanael to Jesus, but just a few verses earlier, who brought Peter to Jesus? It was Andrew, his brother, wasn't it? When you go back to Luke chapter 5, verses 27 through 29, you read a little earlier there that Levi, otherwise known as Matthew, he was a tax collector. Jesus called him to be what? What did he call him to do? Come and serve as one of his apostles. You know what Levi did immediately after accepting that call of Jesus? He had a gathering in his house. Guess who he invited? Other tax collectors. Guess who was there? Jesus. And so that's using your relationships to hopefully bring someone to Christ. In Mark chapter 5, Jesus in the Gadarene country meets this man that is demon-possessed. His demons are cast out into the herd of swine. They run off into the Sea of Galilee and drown. You remember when Jesus was about to leave, the Gadarene man, he wanted to go with Jesus. Jesus said, no, but you stay here. And I'm paraphrasing. You go and you tell others that you know about what's happened in your life. That's relational evangelism. In John chapter 4, Jesus is outside of the city of Sychar, meets at a well there, a woman we simply call the Samaritan woman. After his disciples come back after buying bread in the city of Sychar, Jesus is going to receive them. The lady goes back into the town, and she begins to tell people in the town about this man outside the city who's told her all about her life, though he was not intimately acquainted. times past. And all of a sudden, people start coming out of the city to see this man that she has testified about. And so that's relational evangelism. The Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 24 and verse 26 with one of the leaders of government. For 2 years, he's going to see a man by the name of Felix, and he's going to have an opportunity to tell him more about God's will for his life. That's using your relationships. And so when we talk about relational evangelism, we're talking about using our relationships, the relationships that we have today, maybe the relationships that we have tomorrow, to help lead someone to Jesus Christ. Now, in the religious world at large, among those today who claim to follow Jesus Christ, this has been probably for the last 20 years the most effective means to bring someone to Christ. You go and you talk to any religious group that claims to follow Jesus Christ, and you ask them over the last 20 years what has led people more than anything else, what has caused people to come to some knowledge of Jesus Christ, they will tell you friendship evangelism or relational evangelism. Now, I will say this. Relational evangelism is starting to decline a little bit in the United States. How many of you can remember the bus ministries back in, the 70s, early 80s? How many of you can remember that? Okay. We don't run buses any longer today. Why? It's not as effective as it used to be. That's the way things occur in our society. Trends may be very, very popular today, but tomorrow may not be as well used and effective. It may be that we're kind of getting on to that fringe when it comes to relational evangelism, that maybe what has been very helpful and beneficial in times past is no longer reaching that same level of success. However, according to statistics that we can find, Lifeway Research and the North American Mission Board in 2009, they did a joint study together, and they indicated that 1 in 2, or in some cases 2 in 3, of our friends, our acquaintances, were open to someone saying, hey, would you come and maybe be a part of a church service? Would you come to a religious gathering? Would you come to a social gathering? And so Barnes Research is going to indicate that even among those who are not affiliated with any religious group, they will be open many times as well. Now, let me down the bottom. Let's get into the nuts and bolts of this. What are some things that our friends, our acquaintances, those people we have a relationship with, what are some things they may be open to receiving an invitation from us about? First bullet there, an invitation to a non-faith event. Now let me describe to you a non-faith event. A non-faith event is an event where Christians are going to be present, but yet you're not going to be engaging in the event in first say studying the Bible or worshiping. Okay? Things that would be identified by people of the world as some kind of church gathering or church service. Now, a few months ago we had a fish fry. Every year we have a fish fry. We have a lot of other activities throughout the year when we get together and we just enjoy fellowship with one another. That would be classified, at least in this sheet, as a non-faith event in the fact that the purpose of us gathering is not necessarily to worship or to study God's Word, but it is just to be together as Christians. Now, there are also opportunities to invite others to a social event comprised of similar people. Not necessarily a church-sponsored type of event, but let's say we have a group of maybe 5 to 8 people that come over to my house on Friday night. All of them are Christians, and again, that's not for the purpose of worship or Bible study, something like that. It's just an opportunity for Christians to get together. Now, I'll stop right here on the first two bullets. Most of our acquaintances, friends, may be open to this type of invitation. These two types are greater than any others, even more so than the last two that I put here in terms of percentage. Why is that? Because we're going to talk about inviting people to attend a faith event, for instance, a worship service like we'll have on September the 20th, Friends and Family Day. Invitation while visiting in someone's home, that may be something like door knocking or actually reciprocating, being in one another's homes. Why number one and number two on the bullet there, why would this be maybe a little more effective? to a car dealership and look at a car and say, I want that one. Go inside, do the paperwork, and then drive off the lot. Is that the way we handle buying a car? What do we do? What do we do before we buy a car? You want to check it out. You better go test drive that thing, right? You better go kick the tires. That's the old phrase you use for that. You better look inside. You better put it out on the road somewhere to make sure it's actually operational, right? We test drive a car. Why do we want to test drive a car? We test drive the car because we need to imagine what would owning this car be like. How would it drive and how would it fit my needs, right? Okay? Now, I want you to think about people being invited to what we call a non-faith event. People being invited maybe to a home where there's going to be a gathering of six or seven Christians there. It gives the non-believer an opportunity to kick the tires. To say, what are these people like in a normal, everyday kind of setting? And I say that because the world, especially with the churches of Christ, how does the world portray us? Right, we're cult. We have cultish traits about us. What else? Narrow-minded. What else? Aloof. Only folks going to heaven. There are so many perceptions people have. Guess what? In a social setting, when you have an opportunity to visit with other people, you have an opportunity to hear how they think. Now, that's something we can't do right now. We don't have an opportunity to talk among ourselves in this kind of gathering. When we worship in a few moments together in our morning worship assembly, we don't have time to interact and talk among ourselves. But in these social types of gatherings, guess what? We get to visit with one another. We get to talk with others. They get to understand, hey, folks aren't like I thought they were. Especially the way society portrays them. And so many times we will have a greater opportunity to invite someone to come to one of these activities before they would ever come to a worship assembly or to some kind of special day like our friends and family they will have on September the 20th. Now let's go to the next page. Letter E. Moving really quickly now. There are some things that are interesting to just about everybody in our society. It does not matter if someone identifies himself as a Christian or not. These are things on the top of the sheet here that are important to just about everyone. Number one, I want to live with a high level of integrity that tops the list. People want to live an honest life surrounded by honest people. Number two, I want to have a closer relationship with God. Number three, I want to have a clear purpose in life. Number four, I want to have close personal relationships. In all of these cases, these are people, no matter if they call themselves Christians or not, this is the way they think. And again, that's good news for us. So the person that you think may say no to your invitations, they may have a lot of things, interest-wise, in common with you. Okay? Now, there are some times, letter F, when people are more receptive to invitations from us. Different times of the year. I always grew up hearing that whenever someone had their first child, more than any other time maybe in their life, they would be interested in spiritual matters. Why? They all of a sudden have that responsibility on their shoulders to bring a child up. Am I going to bring a child up absent of the knowledge of God? Or am I going to bring a child up knowing about God's people, knowing about God's plan for salvation, so forth and so on? And so, times like that, we've been told in the past, this is a good time. The number one time people are open to religious invitations during the Christmas season, during the holiday season. Why is that? Why would you say that? Almost 50% of people will be open to an invitation during the Christmas season of the year to come to some type of gathering. Why? Right, you've got actually something the world views as the birth of Christ, but probably more so than any other time in our society. In the course of a year, people are talking about religious things, right? Probably more so than any other time of the year. Religiously speaking, we understand that we do not know when the birth of Christ is. We do not know a date, and furthermore, God has not told us per se to celebrate that as a congregation. But here is the point that I'm trying to say. In the world at large, there's great focus on Christianity during this time. And we normally use the Christmas season as a time kind of about to do a whole lot, right? I mean, if you're like me, you're going from one Christmas gathering to another family gatherings. Yeah, from Thanksgiving to Christmas in our family, we're putting miles on vehicles in our home. It's a busy time. That's an excellent time, however, to be inviting others to come and be with us for different things. Easter, slightly behind Christmas, probably for the very same reason. Again, two times a year when our culture still will take a little bit of time and say, let's focus on religion, and so that's probably it. After a national crisis like 9/11, following a natural disaster, following the birth of a child, those are all times people may be open to invitations. Letter G, some things that are important for us to keep in mind in inviting others. Be committed to the relationship. Many people, and it may be the reason relational evangelism is not as effective today as it used to be. Maybe because some people say Christians are just using other people in the relationships. If you befriend someone or you use the relationship to bring someone to Christ when they obey the gospel, don't drop them like a hot potato after they obey the gospel. Continue that relationship. Make that relationship be genuine. Pray for yourself, for others, for your relationships. Our list of 25 that we've talked about on and off during this time frame, more than likely it's relationships. Pray in different ways for different people on that list. Ask others to do something for you. Okay? We have been doing this in youth circles for many years. There's a youth rally that's going to be down in Mobile in a couple of weeks, for instance. What do we tell our children to do? Invite a non-Christian friend to go with you. And invite people to come and do something. And maybe you're doing a service project somewhere with someone else in the congregation. Invite a non-believer to be part of that. Expose non-believers to Christian brethren. Don't have dual language. You ever notice that in church, we sometimes have church speak? It's different language than we use in an everyday setting. And that's oftentimes confusing to those outside of Christianity. Invite non-believers in your home. I'll say this about inviting non-believers in your home. Lonnie Jones is a minister up in Huntsville. We've had him here before to speak to us. Lonnie Jones and Jackie, his wife, they bought their first house they ever owned when they first came to Memorial Parkway and began working with the congregation. Lonnie will tell you the story. There was a sweet lady in the congregation that came up to him shortly after hearing that they had bought their first house. Her message to him was, Lonnie, you use that house to the glory of God. God's blessed you with a nice house. God's blessed you with an opportunity to be surrounded by many good Christians. Use that house. In other words, open your house up and let people come in. Are we using our houses? Think about how much we pay for a house. Are we using our houses for the glory of God, or do we selfishly keep all the things related to our house to ourselves? That's a question you need to answer for yourself, one that I need to answer. Remind, choose words carefully. You start gossiping about people that your congregation, folks that you know, don't want any part of your congregation. It's that simple. Also, when you do invite others, they accept your invitation. And that is fine. If Brooks invites someone and they're going to come on September 20th, be fine if Brooks come to me and say, I'm bringing somebody on September the 20th. I'm going to be bringing them. That's one of the things. You meet them and you become a little acquainted with them. That'd be fine in that sense. But if Brooks is going to want to tell me for 30 minutes that I'm going to call that person, that's not going to be a good thing. I'll tell you why. Sometimes when guests come with us, one of the questions they may say is, I'm sure you've heard everything about me. It's really a good answer to be able to say, no, I don't know the first thing. I don't know the first thing. So what you share about those who accept invitations, that's very important. Share relevant messages of faith with non-believers. They start talking in Christian time about the birth of Christ. Lead that to a productive spiritual conversation. Invite. This is what statistics say. It takes 6 to 8 invitations before someone finally says yes. When do we normally quit? All right, after the first one, it's hard to muster up the courage to ask the second time. 3 times might be the limit most of us would ever run. 6 to 8 times. A lot of people today say it took that before I finally said yes. And so that's relational evangelism. All right, let's move to another aspect in which we'll finish our discussion today. Let's talk about guest evangelism. going to be focusing upon what we refer to as our visitors. I would go ahead and say this. Guests do not like to be called visitors. I don't know why. I don't know the answer to the question of why. We have used the term visitor, visitor, visitor for many years. Visitors like to be known as guests. This is the way I approach it. You'll hear me speak of it sometimes from the podium behind me. Welcome our guests today. If they would rather be called guests than visitors, I don't care. I'm just glad they're here. And if they would rather be called guests, it's not going to hurt me to call them a guest as opposed to visitors. So understand, to some people, to be called a visitor, that is somewhat offensive. A guest is a softer tone, I suppose, so that's just something important to think about. But guests are people who come to us. Most of the time, when we think of congregational guests, they're going to come to our morning service on Sunday morning to our worship assembly. Now, I want you to stop and I want you to think for just a moment right there. We have an hour to an hour and 15 minutes with some people. People who come into our midst for one service on Monday. Okay? They come into our midst, and the person who normally comes, and this is important, let it be, the person who comes to us is going to be a different type of person than normally the person we're going out to in the world. Everything we've talked about thus far has been going out to people. This is actually people that come to us. Okay? When they come to us, they have an interest already in spiritual matters. They would not be here otherwise. We'll talk about that in a few minutes. Why do people come to us? They already have an interest in spiritual matters. The person that I have among my relationships, he or she may not be interested in Christianity. The person that walks in this door and is here 30 minutes from now for our worship assembly who is a first-time guest, they have an interest in spiritual things. That's a different person than many people that we will encounter in the world. Now, I want you to think about this. I was sitting down and talking with a good brother over in Starkville, Mississippi about this a few weeks ago. This is what he said. He said, think about it in the light of God's providential work. God has moved in someone's life enough they are stirred that they are moved to come to us. These are not people that we have to go to. People come to us, we let them walk in and out of our doors. We do not impact them in any way significantly. He said, you wonder what God thinks of in heaven about that. God's stance. I brought them to you. I'm not asking you to have to go reach them. Go somewhere. I have actually led them to you. I've done half the work. What are you going to do with those people that come into our midst? All right, what are some things these seekers are looking for? Letter three. Number one, to experience God. Now, I want you to think about this, and I want you to think about a normal worship assembly on Sunday morning. They are coming to experience God. They are looking for training for their children. A lot of them will not have children. In fact, more people that come into our doors today are going to be single. Or, if they are married, they don't have children at home. Percentage right now is around 60% single or married without children at home. That's different than the guests we used to have 20, 30 years ago. They may not necessarily have children, but they expect training for children to be provided. They look for a practical understanding of the Bible. The religious world is confusing, even in Christian circles. They don't want more confusion. They want simplicity. They're looking for a non-threatening environment. We'll talk about that a little later in just a second. They're looking to find solutions to everyday problems that come from an authoritative source. Now, what are they not looking for? They're not looking to meet people like themselves. 30 years ago, this was different. People oftentimes came to the Lord's church hoping to meet many people just like themselves. This is the reason that this is no longer true. There is a club for just generally anything and everything nowadays. If you are a 30-year-old single man in the city of Tuscaloosa and also Northport, there are worlds of groups of people that you can be part of that's just like you. So people are no longer looking to the church per se for people just like themselves, like they used to. Curiosity. They're not interested in, well, I knew this Christian and the way he handled things in life. It was so much different than everybody else. That's normally not the case. It's going to bring them to our doors. They're not here to protect themselves against the wrath of God. You would hope that maybe that might be the case, that a non-believer would say, you know what, I'm fearful about God's wrath, and thus I'm going to come to a service of the Lord's church and hopefully find a way to protect myself against hell. That's not the case. That's not what they're here for, generally speaking. They're not here because of a new worship style. They advertise that a new contemporary service, as opposed to the traditional service. That's not going to be necessarily something that most people of the world are looking for. They're not trying to be here just because friends and families have been on their back. They're here because they want to be here. Okay. They're here because they have chosen for an hour or so out of their time to be present. They are desiring to be here. Now, what do they look for? Our guests, when they come. Number one. Friendliness. You go and you talk to people in the Lord's church who have identified with congregations. Why? The top reason across the board by an overwhelming majority. Many of us have. I've been in congregations before where I don't even know if they acknowledged or even knew I was there. And that's not because I sat in the very back pew and came in 10 minutes late and left 10 minutes early. Doesn't leave a favorable light in the ground if people are not friendly. By the way, I think that we have a reputation as a congregation as being a friendly congregation. Not something to sit on our laurels about and just simply say, okay, we're a friendly congregation, leave it at that. Because we're a friendly congregation doesn't mean we'll be one tomorrow. We have to keep working at it. Friendliness. We've already talked about the second bullet there. They don't like being put on the spot. In the past, we may have said, all of our guests, please stand up. Come on, that's not a good thing. Don't ask your guests to wear a name tag if no one else is wearing a name tag. They do not like that. They like clearly marked directions when it comes to parking, when it comes to Bible classes. They appreciate having empathy. The lady that comes in, if she's got three young children, if she gets disapproving glances because her children aren't behaving the way others think that she ought to have them behave during a worship assembly, that's not very empathetic towards her situation. Genuine joy in the action of believers. Now think about this. We've got an hour on this Sunday morning. They don't see joy in our worship assembly. They come to the conclusion it's not a very happy group of folks. Absence of rudeness, anything that would be rude, it's not going to be perceived well. All right, letter F, and I've got to hurry here, but these are some things we never need to say to our guests. And I'm just going to go ahead and say, when I looked at this list from Tom Rainer is the founder of Lifeway, and he writes a religious blog. He touches literally thousands of people in religious circles, and he gets feedback from thousands of places. When he writes a list, and he begins this with, you're sitting in my seat, this is what I did when I read it. I said, surely nobody in the Lord's church would ever say to a guest, you're sitting in my seat. But yet in the first two places, Brother Joe and I have been in this series, I've had people come up to me after class, even in the class, and say, it's happened to me, and it's even happened to me here before. I want to say this, and I want you to hear me very well. We do not have assigned seats in this auditorium. There is no seat that is your seat. A guest comes in and sits in my seat this morning, I'm going to find somewhere else to go. Okay? If I go and I tell a guest, you're sitting in my seat, Tom Rainer says it like this, they will get up and they will never come back. They will never come back. Now, do you want that on your conscience before God one day? Do you want to stand before God and God say, now, this guest came into the assembly and sat in the place you normally sit, and you ran them off because of the way you handle that? It's come to my attention. This is more prevalent than what I thought it would have been. Folks, if there is somebody in our seat, we need to be gracious about that. Very gracious about that. Is your spouse with you? If you ask that to one person that's by themselves, their mentality, you're not asking it for anything outside of just probably having a conversation. They may feel like this. See, old people are among those creatures. Bless the house spouse. Be careful what you ask. Are these your children? Again, folks without children, I really welcome you. Be careful. I'll tell you this. Years ago when I was at the Memorial Parkway, following Lonnie Jones, being the punching bag for a guy that had been there for 17 years before me, I asked a lady shortly after my tenure started there if she was pregnant. I never asked a lady again if she was pregnant, because she wasn't. There are some questions you ask of people that it's either going to be 100% great or it's going to be 100% bad. Stay away from asking those kind of questions that can be 100% bad. Okay? You ask someone, is this your first time? No, I've been here 10 times. Or, yeah, that actually happens. Sure. Okay? Yeah, sure. Ask, the service has already begun this morning. What you're saying is, then you're not welcome. You're not careful. Be careful about those kind of things. You don't look like a member here. Well, what's a member supposed to look like? Do I have to look a certain way in order to be part of this congregation? Your children were going out this morning. And folks with children, I've said this before and I'm going to say it again. Children are going to misbehave. Looking over at folks that are studying with children with a disapproving stare, or going up to them and somewhat reprimanding them after service, is not the way to go about that issue. Is not going to be received well, and frankly, is very unkind and perceived as unsympathetic. There is a way to handle that. Things to say to you, yes, thank you for being with us today. Can I help you where you need to go? Please take my seat. Or even better, why don't you come and sit with me? Meet somebody out in the foyer this morning and say, would you come just sit with us? That would be received very well many times. Let me help you with your children or find a Bible class, so forth and so on. Let me introduce you to so-and-so. The more people we introduce them to, the better off. Here's my phone number and email. Somebody's new to our community, okay? Brand new to town, you find that out. They may not know everything they need to know living in the community. You might appreciate having a phone call to contact somebody that can help them. Hey, where do I need to go to set up my gas for the house? Where do I go pay my power bill at any time? Questions like that, newcomers out of the community, you can step in and provide some information. Would you go to lunch? I had a lady that told me in the last class, she said, went somewhere one time before we got out the door, somebody asked us to go eat lunch. Didn't know what it was going to be, but we accepted, went to their house and we ate ham sandwiches. It was very simple, didn't cost a whole lot, but she said we felt like we'd been treated like orphans. Doesn't have to be expensive. Doesn't have to be fancy. Just has to be a genuine hospitality. What can help us letter H more than anything else reach our non-Christian guests? The first 5 minutes after our assembly ends, what do we normally do? Ms. Margaret's for free. Ms. Margaret, how you doing? What's been going on in your life this last week? Let me tell you about it. That's what we do. Amen said, we go find most of the time people, if we don't have somewhere to be, we go find folks that we know, that we want to share something to, that we want to have something shared to us. If all of us will take the first 5 minutes after our conclusion of assemblies, if all of us will look around for the first 5 minutes and say, where's a strange face? Where's somebody that I don't know? And use those 5 minutes to reach out to people that you do not know, we'll have a great impact on our guests that come our way. There are some people who already do that, but for the first 5 minutes, that's what I do, that's what our family does for the first 5 minutes. Invite guests to go to lunch. Again, it doesn't have to be fancy. Write down, remember names as our guests. I will go ahead and tell you. If folks remember my name after I've gone somewhere, I'll walk in the door again, somebody greets me by name. That's impressive. That's impressive. Write down that person's name. And Facebook, by the way, helps us in that sometimes. Write an appreciation note to our guests. On our Wednesday sheet, every week, there are our guests and their addresses. We have one member of this congregation that told me in a class earlier, this was one of the reasons she identified with this congregation as opposed to others, is because some members wrote down a note and sent it to her. But more than anything else, the last thing, treat people like you want. If you have ever gone into some gathering where you are a total stranger, and when you're not very much like those people that you're around, how would you like to be treated. The golden rule, however you wish others treat you, you treat them. Matthew 7, verse 12. It's the golden rule. That will help us have a greater impact on our guests. Relational evangelism, yes, evangelism. Indirect ways we can help impact others for Christ. Hope you have enjoyed the class this morning. We'll finish it up next week on Sunday morning.